Chad, it's all yours.
I have a picture of Mark Donaldson's new child on my phone, but I have no idea how to unlock it. If anyone knows where the mute button is.
Oh, it's on the top.
I have that same problem.
Apparently I can do that. Anyway, thank you guys. I hope this night finds you well. I appreciate everyone coming to the meeting tonight. We have a very exciting program. I'd like to introduce Kevin Jones. Kevin comes to us from NASA as a chief social media networking strategist, and he is also the president of Engaged Learning. He's going to talk to us tonight about best practices for social media, and what I found was interesting is apparently it's not about the technology, but it's about the goals of your program. And so please help me, join me, if you will, in welcoming Kevin to our Charlotte chapter meeting.
Thank you. I'm excited to be here. Especially on your birthday. I planned it just for you. I know. So we had to spend the next hour and a half together or so. I am not a fan of PowerPoint at all, but I've got it. And so I'm gonna use it if you guys don't speak up. So as I go through this, feel free to ask questions. Feel free to pop up and say something, and you know, I'm gonna guess what you need through this, but if you have another need that you need something answered, I am more than willing to do that as well. Of course, we'll go through a lot of this, but really, at any time, ask a question. If we need to skip ahead, I'm okay with that. I'm really fluid with this kind of stuff. First of all, my background is in learning and performance improvement as well. I have been doing that for a while, since 2000, so not an incredible 30 years or something, but and I got into social media and social networking because I was hired onto a company who said, we need an LMS. I said, okay, well, let's see what we can do. And I started down the LMS path. Then I went to, it was an ASTD Tech Knowledge Conference. And I went there and I learned about social media. There's just one class about it. And I went, oh, I got happy all of a sudden. And I realized that what that company needed at the time was not an LMS. What they needed was something more like this. And so I started researching this and getting into this, and serendipitously, I started going to some other conferences, and now my focus is on using all of this newfangled tech notes stuff for inside of organizations for learning performance improvement. But as Morgan and I talked about earlier, there's nothing new about this. We think this is all nifty cool stuff, but there really isn't anything new about this. It's just different ideas coming together in different ways is all this is. I want to get a sense and a feel for you guys. How many are in learning specifically? Okay. Tell me overall, comfort level wise, from a personal standpoint, how comfortable are you with social media? If you feel confident, raise your hand. Good. You're confident?
I have a question.
Yes. Good. First one.
Just so I'm clear, exactly how are you defining social media?
That's the first thing we'll get to. Good. We'll get to that in a quick sec. Because that's a long explanation. That's not so simple. How many of you are scared of it? Anyone scared? Okay. Good, you didn't admit it. Because I know there are some. I give presentations like this all the time. And there are people, when it's in a working group setting, I get people who are belligerent, who are rude, who will say, "God, to be kidding," and try to tear me apart. And I just want to smile. they really get really passionate. I mean, really passionate about this, as if I'm evil, or I forgot to wear deodorant, and I have totally offended them or something. But what they don't understand is how this can help them, and they're just kind of scared of that. And we'll go over why people are scared around this as well. So although I do a lot of social media stuff, I am not a social media fanboy. I'm not someone who eats Twitter for breakfast and tells you that I just ate a breakfast burrito on Twitter. It says that's not me. I don't see that as productive. And I have a few other things that take my time. I don't have time to be on social media all the time. I have much more important things to do.
Use your kids?
All of them?
Yes, they are. They are.
Seven?
Wow. Seven of them. No 20.
Excellent.
What was that? So really I have no time to goof around and such. What I use social media for, what was that? No. Okay, I've got too many of that. Go ahead. Alright, that's alright.
She said you had time
to goof around. Yes, that's a good point. I was introduced to someone one time as, this is Kevin Jones, he has 7 children, and he goes, dang, you need to get a new hobby. that was a great response there. But again, I use social media mainly for, and what we'll talk about it more for, is not the marketing end of things and the external, but really internal to an organization. How can we use it to learn, to be better, to be more efficient? Where it makes sense, where it doesn't make sense, because some people, you know, it's kind of like when e-learning came out and really got popular, people thought, e-learning is it. E-learning is going to save the day. We're going to do everything e-learning, and there won't be any ILT, there won't be anything else, any seminars. We're going to do e-learning, and you may be in an organization that only does e-learning, because I have heard that there are some, but that's going a little bit overboard. Using this for everything, and this is going to save the day, isn't true either. This needs to be used in moderation, at the right times, at the right places, and when it's used correctly, then great, everybody can get along, and we can do great things, but until then, people will abuse it, and you will see abuses. Just get used to it. First thing we have to do is make sure we all understand what social media is, back to your point, and talk the same vernacular. And what we're going to do, I'm going to give you hopefully a few new tools that you can take back to your organizations to talk to them, to explain what this is, and listen to their fears and say, all right, I know you're scared about that, but I learned at this little ISPI thing that we can, you know, go a different direction and calm. Sometimes it's calming them down, sometimes it's just alleviate some of their fears. So what we're going to talk about is what is the difference between Web 1.0, Web 2.0, a CMS, content management system, social media, and social networking. They are very different, and we need to understand why. Does anybody want to take... Is anyone brave enough to go for that? Well, not the differences in all of them, maybe, but I guess a lot of people think that, for example, Web 2.0 is the same as social media and social networking, and they're very different. And what distinguishes Web 1.0 from Web 2.0?
Well,
very good. anyone else have any other ideas as well? Yeah. Yes, you can start.
Okay, I would say that social media is all the things that we use to communicate with each other, whether it's photographs or messaging boards or videos or audio, podcasting, whatever. And social networking is the use of all those things to talk to each other and communicate.
Good.
And I agree with all the others.
Okay. Good. Yeah.
For me, social media is, at least in the, you know, the training environment, professional development, is sending out information and then asking your users to talk to you and also talk to their peers. It's not just I talk, you listen, I'm the instructor, you guys listen. That was Web 1.0 probably, or maybe worse. It's very interactive, and one of the new things out there is the importance of learning and listening. That listening piece is really crucial because it shows people that you actually care.
Good. Okay, I'm going to give you kind of a step-by-step on the differences. And not only the differences, but why they are different, which is probably even more important than that. And we're going to look at it from, I'll get to that. Right now, there's Web 1.0. We're going to start with that. Very similar to books and the Ten Commandments. It's very, I am the expert, and I am giving information to you. It is very, like you said, very one way. And you said as well, very one way. It is from me, I am the expert, and me to you. And we're going to look at all of these in the context of who is communicating, who owns the information, what's the purpose of it, and the focus as well. And each one is a bit different. And there's a natural progression, and I hope you guys will see that it was kind of an evolution of how we got to where we are today. And then maybe we can talk about what we think is what the next step is. Because I'm sure there's got to be some other step beyond this. But with Web 1.0, I am the expert. The owner is that one person. I write a book. The content is mine. The book is mine. I mean, I may sell it to you, and you may buy the book, but it is mine. Expert, purpose of it is, like you said again, for me to push out information. I don't care, in book form, really, and in Web 1.0, I don't care about feedback. And in some, and in many circumstances, even today, Web 1.0 is perfectly okay, and it's appropriate. It's probably the best use in some things. So we don't want to say, oh, that's old stuff, we don't want to use it. There are certainly some uses for Web 1.0. And the focus is on the content that I, as the expert, push out to you. An example of this, as we have shown, is this is NASA Marshall's inside page. It's an internet page. Whole bunch of stuff created and links to it. Real basic. We've all seen that before. Nothing fancy by any means. So, we go from Web 1.0, where I am the expert pushing it out, to we are the experts. In fact, it's just we, because I'm not the only expert, but we are as well. So we want to get together and push out information to you. This is kind of what I call Web 1.5, because it's right in the middle, and it's taken care of a lot by a content management system in our world. But we can also link it to TV and radio and magazines. We're all getting together, publishing something, and putting it out. It's still a published mechanism one way. So who's the owner? There are a few people who are the owners. We're still experts pushing it out, and the focus is on the content. Same as Web 1.0. The only difference is who is pushing out the information. Next. Those of you who are writing, I'll wait a quick sec. An example of this. Can anyone give me an example of this? Okay, good. Can you give me a web example?
A wiki?
Nope, not quite there yet. Yeah?
I was going to say WikiLeaks.
Yeah, not quite. And I'll show you why.
CNN.
This is SharePoint. SharePoint is 1.5. It is, we are creating information and pushing it out to you. And even though SharePoint is, 2010 has some content, or has some social things that they've thrown in there. Are any of you from Microsoft, by the way? I would have to anyways. Even though there are some social aspects, I'll show you the difference and why it is very, very different. And it's still a content management system and not a social platform. You can finagle it that way, but there's a lot of finagling to do. So we go from, we want to share, is that Mac? Yeah, we are experts to, wait a minute, if I can share and you can share and you can share, why don't we just let everybody share? Before, we haven't had the technology to do that. Now, we have the technology to allow anyone to share, and we see that all the time. So, we go from here, which is Web 2.0, sorry. So we call that all Web 2.0, where we can all share. Who is doing the communication?
Everyone.
Who owns it? That's where people slam on the brakes. This is place number one where people slam on the brakes. Is who owns the content? And that is when I started getting into this and started putting social stuff in place in an organization. People are not comfortable in taking someone else's content and changing it because it is there. They have to go. In fact, it was really funny. I would have a social thing up. Someone would create information, then if they wanted to add to it or change something, they would email the person. Do you mind if I change something on your wiki, for example? Yeah, sure. Then they'd go back and then change it. And so they're using it all wrong. But they didn't understand this very simple fact that I can create something. How many of you have seen on YouTube Double Rainbow? Raise your hand. Okay, three of you. It's absolutely hilarious. You have to go watch. Write that down. Double Rainbow. Okay, what it is, and this will, even though this isn't an internal example, this will explain it. Double Rainbow on YouTube is a guy who went out into Montana, into Yosemite State Park, I believe it was, and had a video camera, was camping kind of on a ledge, overlooking this absolutely beautiful valley, and he saw a double rainbow. Whipped out his camera and said, "Oh my goodness, double rainbow all the way! No way!" And he talked like this. "Wow, how cool! Whoa! Whoa!" And he would scream like that on the video. And then he got emotional. "What does this mean?" And it became euphoric for him. And he has about 4 or 5 minutes of this, "Oh my goodness, and he's dying." Well, it was out on YouTube for a long time until someone found that and took it and took his voice and put it into made it a music video. And it's hilarious. The way they add the music and make his voice go with the music. And so it just spread like wildfire all of a sudden. And people are just thinking it's the most goofy thing. And it kind of is, but I think double rainbows are pretty cool, I have to admit. But then someone else took their video camera in their car, and went to KFC. And drove like, "Whoa, KFC, no way." And on KFC, they have a sign that says, "Doublelicious." "Doublelicious all the way, no way, woo!" And he goes through the drive-thru like that. And he starts crying at the end of the drive-thru. "What does this mean? Oh!" And it's great. So look that up. Double Rainbow, Double Rainbow music. musical or music or whatever, and KFC Double Rainbow, Double-licious. You'll be laughing a whole bunch. Point is, who owned, I mean, could the maker, I think his name is Hungry Bear 52 or something like that, could he say, whoa, you owe me. You made a video of it, and now I need some cash back for that. Or, that is all mine. Even though you created that, that is all mine. The mindset all of a sudden completely changes to where, yeah, that originally was yours, but I've expanded and made it something brand new. Copyright, for example, the copyright law says it is yours or it's not yours. There is no black or white. How many of you have heard of Creative Commons? Good. If you don't know Creative Commons, especially in our line of work, we need to know what Creative Commons is. It allows you to say, for example, and there are many different mixes of this, you can take my piece, all you need to do is maybe attribute me. You cannot use it for commercial purposes, or you can use it for commercial purposes. You may be able to sell your work, or you may not be able to sell your work. And it has different kind of, it breaks it out. So this whole notion of, I created it, it's mine, you will run into. And it's something that you will have to try to help your culture become. The purpose of it, of course, is to share. We do a lot of that, especially with all of this Web 2.0 and social, all this. The focus, however, is still on content. Great example is YouTube, as we've already mentioned. YouTube, in its purest form, is nothing more. It is not social media, and it's not social networking. It is Web 2.0. I create a video. I put it out here. People comment. I am sharing information, and that's basically what it is. It's a Web 2.0 platform. And if you haven't seen Chicken, 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 write that down and go see that, too. I'm just... See, you don't have 7 children, so you have time to waste time. Okay, next. We go from, wait a minute, okay, if I can share and you can share and we can all share. Oh, sorry, I didn't notice. Question.
Did you say that in your view, YouTube is or is not Web 2.0?
It is.
And the thing that makes it the 2.0 is that we are putting it into the common area.
That, not necessarily, because if you think about it, just the content being in a common area. Yes, yeah, that's the key, where anyone who is appropriate may contribute. So for example, if you have something internal to your organization, you may have an area that not everyone can get to, but you don't want everyone to get to, except for a certain subset of people. It could still be labeled, for example, Web 2.0, even though it's a subset of people. YouTube just happens to be everyone. Yeah.
And using YouTube as an example, in terms of contribution, what specifically would you count as a contribution? Would you count the comments as a contribution? Would you count remaking someone's video a contribution? Would you count voting on it a contribution? Like, what specifically would you consider as contributions to make it 2.0?
All of it. Comments. The comments and the liking and the rating and
yeah.
You bet. That's all Web 2.0. If it did not have comments, if it did not have liking and rating, but you were able to just put it up, it would still be 2.0. It's just that you're able to share, whoever can share with whoever else. And that's it. The functionality will vary all over the place. Was there another hand? Okay. So we go from, we want to share, wait a minute, if we could share information, maybe we can get some work done and actually do something. We can collaborate together. Hey, that's novel. And actually, the jump from Web 2.0 to what is now social media happened very, very quickly. Because as soon as we found out we could share, we can get things done at the same time. I like that. So that's how we got to this spot. Who, of course, is everyone. That hasn't changed. The owner, again, the collective everyone, it's all of us. The purpose, it went from share, as we we saw to collaborate. But here is the real difference, is that the focus is no longer on content, it's on people. And that changes everything. No longer are you dealing with something substantive, something you can hold in a like a book, or something you could print off if it was on the web, but you're dealing with people who have emotions, who are fickle, who are sometimes irrational, and there are different cultures and there are different subcultures. And when you focus on people, the game of web totally changes. In fact, although in my role with NASA, I am under the IT department, and I've told them, and the CEO straight up, this should not be in IT. And this is my personal opinion here. Not everyone's, but it's most everyone's, to tell you the truth. I've talked to a lot of people about this, that it should not be under IT because this is not an IT function. This is all of a sudden a person function, a people function, a human function. And IT people a lot of times don't understand how to deal with people.
Really?
They like, shucker! They like processes. Yeah. Oh, you want an iPhone? Good. You're going to have to fill out this form, then that form goes to your manager, then the form goes over here, procurement, let's see if you have enough money. They like all these real stringent processes. They like projects. They like the projects to be perfect. When you start, and really, email, there's, I don't want to say there's nothing social about email, because there that is social, but it's not, I'm just going to say. But, I mean, that's something that they can manage. When you get into things like social media, I was talking today to someone who was interviewing me for an article for NASA to say, look what we have coming, people get ready for it, we're going to get the social media stuff in. She said, so how do we create a community? And I said, just go and do it. Well, I mean, do you have to go through? No. There's no process. You do it.
Really?
Yeah. We try to give as much, with social media really, you try to give as much power to the people. And let them take off. For example, Twitter. Twitter, does anyone know how Twitter started? It was text messaging over the internet. What it was, because I guess, I don't know if this is still true, but on your phone, when you text message, you're limited to 140 characters. Is that still true?
Yep.
It's 160. Oh, you're right, it is 160, because they had some things that, some tags on the back end they had to add to it so they could say this is your location or this is the time or something, and metadata. They had to add some metadata to it. So they shortened it to 140, thank you. So that's what it started out as. And what it is today, the people who created Twitter did not have a clue that it would even be like this. In fact, I forgot to say, how many of you have Twitter, use Twitter? Okay. If you are using Twitter here, I'm going to give you a high five. If you're not listening to me and you're on Twitter the whole time, go for it. Or if you're on Facebook, on your smartphone or on your laptop, do it. Go for it. If some people are absolutely bothered by that, I am absolutely not. I want you to share as much as you can. So, if you're worried about that, just do it. Feel good about it. But Twitter, and I skipped past it. Hashtags, anyone familiar with hashtags? Okay, it's, what you do is, for example, in Twitter, you do a pound, ISPICLT. That means that whatever I just said has to do with ISPICLT. So if you're on Twitter today, you go in and say, I just learned what the difference between social media and Web 2.0 is, pound, ISPICLT. The whole pound thing came up from a user. A user created that, in the, and it was actually made made popular by the San Diego fires that we had a few years back. Someone said, big fires here, watch out, pound San Diego fires. And everyone started using that, so everyone knew what we were talking about. And that usage just caught on. The whole at symbol thing to identify a user came just because someone started using it. And that's a lot what social media is. IT wants to control every facet of all of their programs. But we as users, we want to use these things as, I don't know. I know this is kind of novel, but as we want to use them. If it works, we want to use it. If not, I mean, I get Martin and I are talking. We, you know, I want to use it this way, and if it's not going to let me, too bad. I mean, you still use it that way. And users are like that all the time. And so social media needs to be about the people and needs to be put in the hands of people who understand people. I almost broke out into something. I
knew you were going to do that.
Oh, I'm glad I didn't. Okay, does that make sense? Example of this is a wiki. Because yes, there is content, but really, it's the interaction between people that makes the difference here. If it was as simple as, I'm going to go in here and put the information there. I remember when I was in grade school, I did that with a friend. I'm typing out the first four pages, you type out the next four pages, and we'll put them together. You know, there's nothing really social about that. But when you get into things like wikis, when you get into discussion groups, all of a sudden you have to start worrying about, oh, did I offend them? Did I say that too strongly? Did I say that in a way that they will take incorrectly because of their background or because of their culture or because of other things? And so it becomes much more dynamic. So as we start collaborating with people, let's say this is our little group, and we start using social media, and we start collaborating with each other and getting to know each other. In fact, that's how I got to know Guy, is through a wiki. I created a wiki for one of my classes. I'm going through my master's at Boise State. Help me out, Pam.
IPT.
IPT.
Instruction and Performance Technology.
Yes. Kind of froze. Sorry. Thank you. Instructional performance technology, and for my final in one of my classes, I created an HPT wiki that listed a whole bunch of things. And he saw it and contacted me and said, "Hey, what are you doing? Because we're looking around for wiki kind of stuff about this." And so we started talking, and that was 3 years ago or so. But you know, that was our little circle. But then all of a sudden we start realizing that, wait, you over there, you know information too that's valuable, and you from across the world, and you next door that I didn't even know existed that lives literally next door, maybe we can all get together. And so what you want to do now is find those people who you didn't know existed before and connect with them. And there are different levels of connect that I'll get into in just a quick sec, but who is doing it? It's everyone. Oh, sorry. Social networking. Yeah. Who? Everyone. Who is the owner of your relationship? Okay. Now you know that's goofy. Because our relationship right here, no one owns our relationship. It just happens. So again, we're on a different level than just content. We're on people. And the purpose and the focus are to network. And there are different levels of networking. You can get really granular with this, but I think we all know this intuitively that me and my family, we're all very intimate. We all know each other very, very well. Me and a friend, we know each other, but we may not hang out together. But we know each other enough that we know some strengths and weaknesses. Great. There are people like Guy and I have known each other for a while and go back and forth on Twitter and other places as well. However, we don't know each other incredibly well, but we know each other well enough that when I met him today in real life for the first time in Carbon, I hopped in the car and we started talking and started talking about his house because I saw that, you know, he lives out on the lake, and started asking about that, and he asked me about the kids, and we could just go from the very beginning. And I do that all the time. I meet people. I've met a number of you that I have talked with on Twitter or in class virtually before as well. And so it's really about connecting up with people you didn't even know were there. If you think about that in an organization, how many of you are from organizations which have 5,000 or more people? Okay, good chunk of you. You can get lost in that, especially if you get 5, 10, 20, up to 100,000. There's duplicate projects going on all the time. If we can tap into the people, if you keep going down lower on, I guess I'm going to say lower on the rung, there are people that I have connected to on Twitter, for example, and this is just one example. I've connected to on Twitter, I know they're there, I know that they have something to do with learning, and maybe a specific type of learning, for example, but I don't need to talk to them, don't really need to converse with them, but when I need them, and I know they're there. Before, we would say, I need someone who knows this, and we wouldn't have a clue of where to go. And that is the value of social networking. It's called weak and strong ties, if you've heard those terms. The weak ties, you know are there, but you really don't converse with. The strong ties are the more strong relationships. And it just broadens your circle of those you can use and that can use you, and you can, and not use as in abuse, but connect with and use if you need to. An example of this is LinkedIn. How many are on LinkedIn? Excellent. You all should be. If you have not raised your hand, do that now. LinkedIn, I'm connected up with people that I honestly don't know. On LinkedIn, really on Facebook, on any social media, you have to have kind of a strategy. My strategy in LinkedIn is link up to everybody. I don't care who it is. Find me. You're all on LinkedIn. Find me. I'll connect up to you. You bet. Because that's one more person that I know. And then you know me. And if you have a question, you go, I wonder about, you know, this little thing about social media. You can contact me. I get back to you. Get your question answered, and we're all good. And same thing. If I know that you are specific to one thing, then I can ask you. So, awesome way to network. In fact, the value of these kind of things and of conferences overall, I say, are more of the networking and the talking with people that you've never talked to before and meeting those people. Okay. So that is the difference between Web 1.0, Web 2.0, CMS 1.5-ish, social media and social networking. Questions? Yeah.
So would something like Google Docs be in Web 2.0?
What do you think?
SharePoint model for that.
But I can type a document with five people at the same time.
start with the strategy first, then you work out the tactics, which is the list of tools, whether it's YouTube or, you know, a podcast or XYZ, Facebook. Strategy first, tactics second. And then you go back up to the top and you go round and round and round and round.
I would do it the other way, because what if your tactic is social media, but that's not truly what you need, but you don't know because you don't know what the tools do?
Well, start with the need, though, first,
yeah,
is what you're saying.
Right.
I mean, social media started in, you know, middle school in the library at lunchtime when I had to get my homework done. Right? I mean, that's social media.
Absolutely.
It's just a technological paradigm.
Good. I love it. See, this is the kind of conversations you, as you talk to your organizations, will be in the middle of. And they're going to start asking the same questions, well, what's this, what's this? And yes, you do have to know the difference between the two, because one does focus on one thing, one does focus on another. However, as we just saw with Google Docs, it can focus on both. For example, and this it shouldn't bother me as much, but it does. When people say, yeah, I'm all out on the social stuff, but they go to YouTube or they go to Flickr. Flickr being a kind of a YouTube for pictures, where you can just upload pictures. And they say, yeah, I'm all into the social stuff. I have a YouTube channel and I have a Flickr account where I post photos. And they think that's social. There's nothing social about that. That's not even Web 2.0. That is Web 1.0. That is me throwing content out there saying, you can look at it. Yeah, maybe you can comment, but I'm not going to comment back. And I'm not going to look at your comments, so they really don't matter. So we can use social media, Web 2.0, social networking tools, CMS tools, as downgraded. I don't know if you can you? I guess you can upgrade them as well, to if there is an up and down hierarchy. But we can use specific things. So for example, I use Google Docs a lot. I'll type something in, all my travel plans go on Google Docs. So my wife can go there and take a look and see when I leave and when I come back and where I'm staying, et cetera, et cetera. And keep tabs on me, as she should. But I also have used it for school, where we've been on the phone and we've all been on the same Google Doc. And we're all typing at the same time. There were about 5 of us. And we were, oh yeah, that's a good idea, add that in. All right, everyone, these pieces that we have all talked about before, let's start adding those in right now. How do we, okay, let's move that here. And you should have seen the screen and the colors and movement. And it was all over the place. That is more social media. That's more than just sharing. That is full collaboration right there. So we can use specific tools for other things. NASA, for example, uses Flickr, and they're the ones I'm thinking of specifically. NASA uses Flickr and YouTube to just push it out there, and they said they have a social media strategy. And I'm trying to show them, no, you don't. You have a Web 1.0 strategy. Good job. Yeah?
Have you ever thought of associating this to Bloom's taxonomy?
Yes. Yes, and I actually, when I get done with school, that's one of the things I want to do.
I'll work with you with that.
Really?
I would love to.
Bingo. Deal. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah.
I have another question.
Okay, please.
Where does CMS Bullet fit in?
So again, a content management system is focused on content. It's not focused on people as much, and it's focused usually on a smaller amount of people being able to create information for a wider range audience. Because if you think of Web 1.0, usually it's a webmaster, and only the webmaster can post information. But with the CMS, they've all of a sudden broadened that out to where really anyone can do it, but it's used more as a, I created it, there you go, out to the masses. That's usually how it's used. Again, it can be used as a social and a web 2.0 type of implementation.
So then a wiki would be an example?
if it's used the correct way, yeah. Or it can be used as a static web 1.0. In fact, okay, this is hilarious. A couple weeks ago, or maybe it was just last week, I was in a training for HR personnel for NASA, because they were talking about web or all the social stuff. And someone from a different center gave an example, and they had SharePoint, and this is what they said, and this just cracked me up, and I tried not to giggle too much. But what they said was, now we have these wiki pages, and look, I can link from one page to another. And he was excited about that. Woo! In that 1991. Wow! And you're doing it 2010. Good job. And so we have all the social media stuff. And so you're right. That's where we need to understand the difference between, because no, that's not a social media strategy. When we talk about web stuff and we talk about social media, we need to understand, as you pointed out, that there's a huge listening component to it. There's a huge sharing component to this. If you're not sharing, it's just web 1.0. If you're not responding and getting into with people and collaborating something, it could be web 1.0 or 2.0. But as long as we understand the difference between these, then we can go into our organizations and speak the right language and say, because what happens is it sets up wrong expectations. And I've seen this over and over and over and over and over again and over and over again. Too many times where people say, you know what? I created a blog. I created a Twitter account. Not being used. This is a waste of time. This is stupid. Well, you know why? Because you're just pushing information out. You're nothing more than a web 1.0 page. You're not using it correctly. You're using it for content push. If you use it as a mechanism for people, it changes everything. And maybe, honestly, maybe you shouldn't use Twitter. Maybe you shouldn't use a Facebook page. Maybe you shouldn't use a wiki internally. Maybe you should use something else, like training, or a worksheet, or a business card. I mean, it could be anything. But again, going back to what Joe said, you have to figure out the purpose of it. Step number one, and write this down if you're taking notes. Step number one is figure out your purpose. Figure out your goals. As soon as you do that, then you find the proper, intervention. There we go. You find out the proper intervention. It may not be social anything, and that's perfectly okay. It may be something old school. Maybe something that having to do with the VCR. Yeah?
You asked the question, why are you afraid? For a lot of organizations, big and small, their biggest fear is, I don't want to put my training out there unless I can lock it up on my intranet. And things like Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn are totally public. There's no copyright. So it's a hard sell for many of them because they don't like lost control. They've got some proprietary stuff, whatever it is, or maybe it isn't, and they're scared as you know what to put it out there.
Good, I'm glad you brought that up because we all have to understand as we get into the social stuff that there's a huge difference between internal social media and external social media. And the reason there's a huge difference, even though they use some of the same tools, very different purposes. Twitter, for example, there are very few times that I would ever advocate using Twitter for an internal purpose within employees. I don't know why you would. I mean, there are some very specific ones that could happen, but overall, no. You may get a Twitter-like client, like Yammer or Socialcast or something, and use it internally, and there you can have some great interaction, absolutely. But not using Twitter. People, unfortunately, when they think of social media, and you'll get a lot of this, when they think of social media, they think, people are talking about breakfast burritos on Twitter. People are talking about, you know, their weekends on Facebook, and I don't want to bring that inside. I don't want to give them a social place for them to mess around.
They're already doing that, aren't they?
With email.
Or in person.
Yes. And so, a lot of, in fact, we'll go through some of these fears. But my answer, and this can be your answer as well, and I use this all the time. It's almost exactly that, it's that vein of thought. That if you're scared of someone messing around, a lot of people say, if someone is messing around on our internal social media stuff, what do you do? My answer is always, first thing, what do you do now? If they're messing around on email, they're messing around talking at the water cooler too much, they're taking excessive breaks, what do you do now? It's the exact same thing. It's not new. And they all of a sudden get that little piece. But it really isn't anything new. And really, and I keep going back to this as well, if people are messing around, then you've got a hiring problem, not a social media problem. You've hired the wrong people. Because those who will mess around whether social media is there or not. They'll find some way to play solitaire or do something else. But don't blame social media for that. It's just the tool. It's the people who use it. Okay. So, what have you heard? I've got a number of them, but I want to hear what you have heard as to why people are afraid to do anything social within your organization. Or what hesitancies or objections have you heard? Or do you have? Yeah.
I don't think it's so much hesitancies as just people think, I don't have time for that. And so they go there, they think someone else is going to supply answers or information or fun stuff, but they're not investing so much. They want, you know, to take out, but they don't want to invest. And so the social media stuff that we've tried, in some cases has worked with a very dedicated team that had a purpose, but just throwing stuff out there and saying, hey, everybody go collaborate, we don't see it happen.
Yeah. And think about, that's a good point, because think about what you're doing, really, even though this is a popular term now, is you're creating a community, a virtual community. If you're going to create a community of real people around a cause, you do it almost the exact same way as you would there in real life as you would online. It really isn't any different. The things that make that work will make this work. So just to say, hey guys, I have a lemonade stand. Everybody come, and you can sell lemonade if you want to. And you know, unless there's a real good purpose to be there, no one's going to come. I mean, why? But if you say, we're going to use this for a specific reason in our company. Specifically, we are going to, for example, a popular community that companies have is one around iPhones or iPads. People are passionate about iPhones and iPads. So they'll talk and they'll exchange, well, what do you know about this this app? Or have you seen this one? And they share information back and forth. You find that passion, find out where people are connecting up like that, you can create a virtual community for them to extend that to other people as well. That's what you want to find. But if you just open it up, it's a field of dreams, build them, they'll come. It doesn't work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would echo that, because I'm in a couple of user groups for specialized software that I use.
Mm-hmm.
And I get regular postings from those two communities, and they're very relevant, and because they're relevant to what I'm doing, I make an effort to read the questions that other people have to see if I can help. And then I'm in some other communities with ASTD related to just the general group of my certification, and there's constantly like all kinds of miscellaneous stuff out there, and I hardly ever read those because there's just so much what seems like, I don't know, I call it trolling. Just like, I'm looking for this, I'm looking for that. It's just so vague that it doesn't have much relevance for me.
Good. Very good. And I'll give you an example that's very similar to that. I use Yammer, which is like Twitter, but four organizations. So you can go up for your company and set up a Yammer account, and only people in your company with your company's email address have access to it. So no one else can see it, although it is housed, hosted on someone else, on Yammer servers. But someone at NASA started it, and so I joined that NASA group on Yammer, and they talk about random stuff. And it's almost like that, you know? And they'll share links, and it's almost like Twitter, where there's a lot of noise, and I really don't care about a lot of it, to tell you the truth. I don't. There isn't a purpose to it. There really isn't a purpose. It's just people getting on and talking to each other, and which isn't bad, but it's not what I want to spend my time doing. On the other hand, Enterprise 2.0. Are you familiar with that phrase? Enterprise 2.0 is the use of social technologies internal to an organization. So basically what we're talking about is really Enterprise 2.0. It is what it's termed. And so there are a group of us, there's a small group of about 100 of us who have this social community, and it's people that do what I do for large organizations. And we are on another thing called Socialcast, which is like Yammer, which is like Twitter. And we talk all the time. And it is incredibly active and so incredibly helpful, because I don't know many people like myself. Not just because I just have 7 kids, but because there aren't many people who do what I do. There are very, very few people who do what I do. And I now have contact, those weak ties have turned into more strong ties, to people at CSC, Eli Lilly, other government organizations, huge companies who are doing what I'm doing. Not just because I just have 7 kids, but because there aren't many people who do what I do. There are very, very few people who do what I do. And I now have contact, those weak ties have turned into more strong ties, to people at CSC, Eli Lilly, other government organizations, huge companies who are doing what I'm doing, and we get to share battle stories back and forth. How do you do this? And we share incredible information, so there's a real, real purpose. And that is how it works. If you don't have that purpose, you open it up, it's not going to work. So that's a really good point to bring up. Okay, so we're going to go through some of the fears, most common fears that I see. And feel free to chime in with your battle stories as well. First one is that people won't come out and say it like this, but a lot of their objections and a lot of their fears have to do with they cannot predict what is going to happen. And they're scared of that. What if this happens? What if? So I want to give you maybe a couple tools and a couple things to fire back when you encounter this objection here. As we talked about, people create processes so they know exactly how things are going to turn out. Ford created an assembly line. When he did that, he knew exactly how much materials and resources to purchase, and exactly what the output would be. He could predict everything. This is University of Oregon campus, where I graduated from, my undergraduate, and with any educational organization, even internally to companies, we want to kind of predict what's going to happen. Once you come through, they try to predict, all right, what are the jobs going to be, and how do we get people ready for that? And that's good, and they ought to, really. That's what they're there for. However, it's becoming more and more difficult because things are changing so rapidly now. Things are really, really being fast, and I'll show you an example, or a number of examples. We're going to go back in time. 2004. Think about what you were doing in 2004. Were you in the same place in 2004 as you are today? If you are in the same position, raise your hand. Okay. Wow, not one of you. Okay, So things change. I mean, just in 6 years, I'll show you. And when I put this together, I was kind of astounded myself, and I didn't realize how much things had changed until I put this together. First thing, 6 years ago, no one knew about Wikipedia. Wikipedia at that point was really, really small, only had 100,000 articles at the beginning of 2004. That was it. Now it's millions and millions in, I don't know how many languages, I have the number somewhere, but a ton of different languages, millions of articles. And so if I was in 2004 and I came to you and I said, guess what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna start my own encyclopedia. And you know what? I'm not gonna pay one person. It's gonna be free. In fact, I'm gonna get people to put in what they know about any subject. Yeah. And it'll be accurate as Encyclopedia Britannica. And it will eclipse Encyclopedia Britannica by a huge amount. Just the theory of economics would lead you to say, absolutely not, you're absolutely crazy. There's no way that's gonna happen. But it happened. And now, I don't know, a lot of people use it, a lot of educational organizations ban it at the same time. So we use it for what it's good for, I guess. And I think there's a lot of good usage. And that's what I was afraid was gonna happen. There was a video there, but it didn't show up, and that's okay. Back in 2004, this is what the new cell phones looked like. How many of you still have that cell phone? All right! Thank you for, well, you have a BlackBerry, fancy schmancy BlackBerry with a new button on the top. That's right. But now we have things that, yeah, they're phones, but do we really use them as phones? Yeah, we make some calls, but they have so much more functionality now that when we had these, thought, wow, all my contacts are on there, and I can put my own background on here. Very cool. All right. And look at this. That was cool, right?
Yeah.
Now, the game has changed completely. Completely. The term Web 2.0 was not popular by any means. It had been used, and in fact, the first major usage happened in 2004. They had, O'Reilly Media had the Web 2.0 conference, and that was the first time anyone had really heard of Web 2.0. And then from that point on, it went crazy. People said, Web 2.0, that's the coolest thing. You gotta use that now. But before that, no one had ever heard of that. No one had ever used the word social applied to technology. That was just dumb. Social technology. Who would have thought of that? But now, it's all over the place. This is a video, as you can see, of a friend of ours named Megan. She was trying out for the BYU flag team. You know, the big old monstrous flags. She did it over YouTube. She didn't go to school and do it. She stood in the gym and flipped them all around right before prom. Uploaded it to YouTube Saturday night. Monday morning, got an email saying, you're on. That's how you audition now. Who would have thunk? Oh, but you can't see it. Laura Gaynor wanted to... her and her husband were moving from one place. Oh, wait, I think from here. Do you guys know Laura Gaynor? Oh, dang. I think it was from here that she was moving from here to Wisconsin. And so she needed to get a new job. I think her husband got a new job there. So she went to Wisconsin, and she had found this Comet branding company that she wanted to be a part of. And so she got on Facebook, on Twitter, on YouTube, on a number of other things, and plastered it and said, hey, Comet Branding, I want to work for you. And she printed off a poster, took the poster around to different sites in Wisconsin and said, you know, put the poster up and went next to an icon, and then posted it on Flickr. And then did that with their brand, and then wrote a blog post about it, got on SlideShare, if you know what that is. SlideShare, put up a SlideShare thing for them, and her resume up there. Within, I think 6 days she was hired. Because they saw this. Wow.
When was this?
This was earlier this year.
Yeah.
6 years ago, you would never apply for a position or even think of that. You have your resume and that's all you do. So you can use any of these examples just to show that things are changing very, very, very quickly. And it's not only outside world, but it's inside as well. People want to use different things. YouTube, all these things weren't invented 5 years ago. In fact, 6 years ago. Facebook was invented 6 years ago exactly. But it was only to Harvard and then spread to Yale and then spread to a few more colleges and then spread out from there. But again, that's another technology that was created for one purpose. Girl watching is what it was actually created for. And it's because of the way people use it have come out to be something totally different. Last thing here. Citibank, Bank of America, Fannie Mae. In 2004, they were the number 1, 6, and 9 companies in the world. And then just last year, that's where they are. So what you need to get across is that if you're still trying to predict things as much as you were before, you can't. There are some things that you just cannot predict. And most of all, probably human behavior you can't predict. Okay, another why are you afraid? People want control. And that goes along with prediction as well. I want to be able to control. Joe and I had a good discussion on this before tonight. We see this all the time. I'm going to give you just an example of anti-control. And I used to work for Intel. And Intel, and I loved this piece of that. Intel was a great company to work for. But one thing that I loved about them was their vacation policy. It was, take 3 weeks or so. That was it. They didn't control it. They didn't keep track of it. They didn't care. When you quit or were laid off or whatever, you didn't get compensated for it. It was just, you know, just take 3 weeks off or something. We're good with that. No one's counting. Oh my goodness, do I have enough vacation days? It was, hey boss, you know, I'm going to take these days off. Great, done.
Did you get paid for it?
Yeah. Yeah, sure did.
Cool.
Yeah. And you know what that did?
You never took off, did you? What?
She said, you never took off, did you? I did. But a lot of people didn't. Because they weren't worried about it. So it was like, oh, you know what? I have it if I want to use it. If not, they got rid of some of the small stuff that really did not need to be worried over. They just got rid of it. So you could actually focus on the things that matter in your work.
I imagine. Netflix does. Their policy,
really?
Their policy on vacations takes them.
I love that. Yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah, oh, that's great. So, but apply that to processes. Now, granted, there and then like it sounds like I'm continuing to dog processes, but there are some processes that you have to have. NASA has to have certain processes to make sure shuttle launches happen on time, safely, everyone's on board. Someplace you have to have great processes. But we have overall created processes that are killing us and are stifling us and are excessive. And what happens when we start using social media is these things become transparent. And people have a say all of a sudden in them. So this, when you introduce social media, people are afraid of control because they don't want to give up the control they just got. I'm a middle manager now and I have this control over my group. I don't want to lose control of that group. I just got it. And honestly, where you'll have the most problem with all this social stuff is with middle management. Not the employees. And depending on the executives, some are very, very, very okay with it. Some of them just don't understand and want to learn more, and some are against it. But it's a mixed bag with the executives. But the middle management, almost always, is very, very resistant to this. MIT wanted to attract, obviously, all the time, they want to attract new undergraduates to come to their new high school, or high school seniors to come to their college. So they decided, let's open it up and let new students blog.
Good idea.
And just blog about life. They opened it up. You know what they got? Lulu. Others' advice, go to class, but I think that's bull. But that's for dumb kids who couldn't figure things out on their own. I skipped all 18.03 lectures except for the first, went to no resuscitation, I slept until noon every day, I sleepwalked through the first semester, sophomore year, and I did just fine. This was out on their, they're trying to recruit high school seniors. And this is the kind of stuff that was put up there. And it did.
Yeah.
It did. Why?
Was it so scary, you mean?
It wasn't. You mean they're real people too? That was so transparent and open that students said, this is incredible. I mean, I can picture myself at MIT. I can picture people talk about it wasn't all this way by any means. I mean, they talked about the tough stuff, they talked about the great stuff as well, but every now and then they got stuff like this. They got pictures of this one gal posted pictures of herself in modestly dressed clothes made out of duct tape. Things like that that you just don't want to do. But they allowed it. They posted it up there. And people realized, not just from that, but from other things, that, you know what, college is okay. I can do this. I feel confident. And they link that to the MIT. I'm going to MIT. I want to do that. Think about that internally now. Think about that opening up some of the communications within your organization and what kind of repercussions for good that may have. Now, when we talk about abuse, people get scared. Because, again, it's the control. A book I would highly recommend for all of you who want to learn more about this is called Enterprise 2.0 by Andrew McAfee. Andrew McAfee coined the term Enterprise 2.0. And there is an Enterprise 2.0 conference that I would highly recommend that you go to as well. There's one coming up in San Francisco. But the big one is in Boston in June. Happens every June. And here you learn more. But that book kind of spells out what Enterprise 2.0 is and how to use it within your organization. In there, Andy says he's worked with hundreds of companies, big, small, all the way across. He's done a lot of research. In fact, he was at MIT. That's where he was from. And he started teaching about this and interviewing companies and really diving into it. And he said he has not found one huge, he's found a few minor, but not one big misuse of this kind of stuff. Hasn't found one. He said, so don't be scared of this. This is good. You want to be using this. So we talk about control. It has a lot to do with trust. Wikipedia on the scale is right here, where there's a lot of trust of what people say. I mean, heck, even put in your opinions, and it's okay. Compared to the amount of control, they lessen the control here. If you just mentally put this in your head and think about the different organizations that you are helping, where do they fall on this line? Because although it may not seem like we're talking about social media and social stuff, this is the backbone of social right here. It's this. This is it. If you don't look at the trust factor, you're missing out. You cannot be doing it right. You have to look at the trust. You have to look at the culture. It is more a cultural thing and a trust thing than it is a technology thing. This much technology, this much everything else. People are afraid things like this will happen. I got these off of Facebook. Frustrated, tired. See a pattern? Yeah, you spelled frustrated wrong twice. People show their ignorance all the time. Just finished eating a raw chicken breast. No sweat. Looks like somebody owes me $20. You're gonna die, dude. Sign the law for sure. I ate chicken, not salmon. This is what they're afraid of. I mean, they're afraid that people will go out and show just how stupid they are in their internal organizational blog or their Facebook-like application or whatever it is.
That happens now.
It does. Thank you. It happens all the time now. Jen is excited to find out tomorrow she'll be an aunt or an uncle. Jen is going to be an uncle. Nice. Sandy, anyone know where I can download a webcam?
Wow. Yikes.
From Twitter, just failed my first drug test. Whoops. Yeah.
You don't want to put that stuff
no.
on Twitter.
No. Just lied to my boss to leave work for a bit. Me starting accounts is a family emergency, right? Oh boy. Okay, this comes back to the thing, you hire the wrong person. At this point, it's not a
but you found out real quick.
Yep, real quick. Done. I found it. Right. Totally just lied on my application. Oh boy. People, that's what people are worried about inside. But you know what? People will do that.
People and finding out about it anyway.
Absolutely. They do it all the time. And that's one thing you have to realize is that not only will it happen, but it happens now, and you have to point out to them where it happens and be specific about it and help them realize that you're right, it happens now anyways. Because people are people and people will do the same things in no matter what tool or no matter what context. Yeah.
I think this is interesting because there was a story
key there, and that's a very good point, because the key there is that the audience in the past has been narrowed. Now, there is no limitation to the audience. It's all of a sudden opened up wide, and that's what people don't understand, is that it can go anywhere. Yeah,
we're doing some training on our information security and that sort of thing, and so
okay.
The blogging and stuff, we're telling our employees that they can't do that at work, and whether it's business related or not, and all that stuff. And one of the things that I keep trying to bring up is that just because you keep people from doing it while they're at work, you need to address and educate people on this anyway, because they're still a representative of you online.
Yeah.
People who know them know you; they work for that organization. And just because you don't want to do it, even if they choose not to do it, there still needs to be education on this sort of stuff,
mm-hmm.
as people are representatives of organizations and that sort of thing. Just like you said, people posting things of themselves don't realize that goes back to their employer as well.
Very, very good point. And listen to that, because your companies will need to help their employees understand what social media is and how to use it for their personal lives. I went to JCPenney and delivered just exactly that. It had nothing to do with JCPenney. It had to do with how to use it for your personal life. And they took a whole day, and that's what we learned, because it is that important.
When you talk about it's a hiring issue, there's a statistic in Virginia about 70% of the applicants were not hired because they're Facebook pages. So it is a behavior, and it is a hiring practice that should be done prior to hiring by
mm-hmm.
the company. The organization needs to take some responsibility in looking at their social behaviors prior to hiring them on.
How we decided is morally acceptable in the virtual world for your work relationship.
Right.
So you can chalk it up to core values of integrity.
But I'm saying, where do they draw the line of, okay, what I do in my personal life, I don't advertise at work. So where is the divide between...
Right. So what I just saw
you are
is that
you
contradicted yourself.
No, what I mean is like...
And in in a good way, though.
Right, but what I'm trying to say, like, I agree that you represent the organization, but what if it's something that I'm okay representing, like something that I would post in the newspaper about myself versus the organization wouldn't want that posted about me and linked back to them? So where do they get to?
We have to realize that not only do people have values, but organizations and companies have values. If they don't match, they don't match. If the company stands for specific values, they can enforce those values. And if you don't want to work for them and you don't have the same values, you can work somewhere else and that's okay.
I have to wear my values.
Yeah.
Every day. Right here. Integrity. Honesty.
Right. And so some of them will say, you know what, we don't want that kind of person here. And
yeah. And that always happened. But now that there's the distribution channel is what's really converted into such a prominent place.
That's right. Yeah.
I'm just wondering if more so than saying something kind of scandalous or posting a weird picture, people could be discriminated against for religious beliefs or political beliefs, and then it could be an issue of, well, you checked my Facebook and you don't like Catholics or something, and that's why I think you fired me.
Right. And that could happen. And you know what? I'm sure that does happen. I can't imagine that it doesn't, because we're people, and there are certain people who will do that.
That can happen anyway, though, because people will put it on the bottom of their resume. I mean, just, again, because of the media, the social, the networking, the technology, I mean, people used to put that on their resumes at the bottom. Awards, honors. It's very important to them. It's a value of theirs. And here we say it depends on if it's a value of the organizations or not. It's a hiring practice.
I was turned down for a job one time because of the number of children I had. Absolutely illegal. There's no way. But you know what? That's their values. I didn't want to work for them after that.
You don't want to be
there. They didn't match up. And I'm okay with that. Tell me what your values are right there. So, yeah, Joe.
I had a quick illustration on that. I'm involved with another professional organization. I was a national member, blah, blah, blah. I'm not going to name who they are. But they misposted a story on me, having me as deceased. and nonetheless, I did a Google search of myself, which I recommend to everybody. It never goes away, guys. And I got on the phone with the people and said, what the you-know-what? And here I am talking to you. You're killing my business. I'm obviously living. I want you to post the retraction. Believe it or not, they would not do it. What I had to do is go to my lawyer, go to my IT people, and said, I want that buried. And there are ways you can get it buried, which is a whole 4-day seminar on.
Yeah.
But, you know, just think, okay, you want to be dead incorrectly? It never goes away once it's on Google.
Right. So because things like that change, rules have changed for a lot of different things like that.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna, yeah, go ahead.
I have a couple other questions, but they're kind of not related directly to this. So,
okay,
just
go ahead
out there, and then you can maybe get them now.
Okay.
One, I was wondering, so how do you use this to replace an LMS? And then, where does Second Life come into all this?
Good questions. Okay, first question. How does it replace an LMS? It doesn't. Now, I will say, knowing that there are LMS people in the world, LMSs sometimes are used, have been expanded to include things that they weren't made for sometimes. And that's not bad, because those LMSs the capability needs to be there. And there's no other place to put it, and that's okay. I know I'm good friends with someone who's VP at an LMS company, VP of product management, and he's looking at putting in social things into an LMS because they just didn't have that capability. It's really different. You can add social stuff to an LMS. You can internally, or you can do it externally, but again, you come back to your purposes. Are you looking at compliance? Are you looking at making sure that everyone has taken a certain class? And passed it, for regulatory purposes. That's very different than I want people to collaborate. Now, an LMS may be able to do both of those things. Not, certainly not all of them can. And maybe it shouldn't be in the same place, but maybe it depends on your organization. Virtual worlds like Second Life, I've seen some companies use it, like IBM uses it a decent amount. I'm not a big fan of it. It's we can get a lot done by just voice and other means. I mean, it's cool, but I don't know exactly how to respond to that. It really doesn't fit into this realm.
Where would
it
fit on your hierarchy?
Nowhere.
Okay. That's fine.
Yeah. I've made a conscious effort to stay away from that kind of stuff.
Okay.
Because that I would be jumping into something totally different at that point. Yeah.
So how are you using it at NASA, and what kind of successes do you see? Where do you see it being most effective?
Okay. Good question. I'm going to jump ahead to give you that answer. See, I just put up a whole bunch of stuff that I know I'd never use, and that's okay. Actually, you know what? No, forget that.
Just listen to the interview you gave on FIR.
On FIR?
Yeah. For immediate release? Didn't you do an interview with Shel Holtz and his buddy? No?
No.
Okay.
I should, though.
He's got to know
that. With NASA, I know this is being recorded. And we'll just keep it kind of a bunch of ourselves. All right? NASA has created Spacebook. Imagine that. Which is like, I mean, that's kind of a cool name, Spacebook. So what they did, they took the tactic of build it and they will come. And so actually one of the senders built it, nobody came. So headquarters took it and built it. Nobody did. So now we have two Spacebooks, and they totally confuse people. But nobody uses them. And so our center, Marshall Space Flight Center, where Marshall is where all the rockets are created, where all you have all the rocket, I'm not, you know, when people say, I'm not a rocket scientist, you don't say that in my town. Everyone is a rocket scientist. The space camp and things like that are there. We're creating our own for that center. And people are using it because we have targeted specific places. And we're actually right now in beta. We just bought a platform for that, and we're starting to implement the production phase of it right now. But people are using it because there are specific reasons to use it. Yeah.
What's your goal for using it?
You know, that's a real good question, because in this, there's a macro goal and there's a bunch of micro goals. And it's really the micro goals that I'm looking at. The macro goal, I don't care about, to tell you the truth, too much, because overall, how the center uses it, it doesn't matter how the center uses it. It matters how you use it, and it matters how you use it, and it matters how individual groups use it. And so what I've done is I've taken something that can kind of cover everything. I try to get kind of like an umbrella application, and then I'll go to specific groups, even specific people, and say, how do you want to use it, or do you want to, or does it work? Yes? Will it work? Great. This is how to build a community. This is how to keep it going, and let's try that. We build it and get it into the work processes, and it works that way. This right here is the handout that some of you may have brought, you may not have, but hopefully you all got that. If not, go take a look at it. It's me and a friend, Dave. We put this together through our experience of building these kind of things and what it takes to put these together. Questions, you have to look at the culture. We have the big things are culture, approach and methods, planning, launch activities, technical stuff, legal and compliance, learning communities, community management, professional development skills competencies. So, this was specifically created for the learning community, although easily transferable to overall performance improvement or Enterprise 2.0 or anything social. Take a look at these. For example, you have to ask yourself questions like, how open do you want this to be within your organization? Do you want the whole thing to be open? Or are there pockets that won't be open? How much of it do you control? How much of it do you trust your employees? See, these are all people issues. And you have to do a really in-depth analysis of what your culture is like so that you can deliver something that people will take and want to use. And that's, and when I talk about strategy, I'm a very iterative person. Are you guys familiar with the Marshmallow Challenge? Raise your hand if you have heard of the Marshmallow Challenge. Okay, just a few of you. I'm going to explain that very quickly. How many of you are familiar with TED, the conference, TED Talks? Good. That's another one you have to go look up. TED.com. Done. That easy. Go look it up. There is a TED, and these TED Talks are 18 minutes long at the most. They won't let them go over that. But one of them talks about the Marshmallow Challenge. The Marshmallow Challenge, you're given 20 sticks of spaghetti, one yard of tape, 1 yard of string, and a marshmallow. And you're in the team, and you're supposed to create the largest freestanding structure with a marshmallow at the top, the tallest, the biggest one that you can. Average is 20 inches. The college graduates, business college graduates, guess where they're at? 10 inches. One of the highest were kindergarten graduates at like 30 inches or something. And he goes on to explain why. It's because those who understand management structure and the way to plan, they get together and say, all right, let's do this. What do you think about that? I mean, it's a whole storm and norm performing thing, right? And they have to, you know, I'm in charge. No, not verbally, but they have to figure that out. Okay, well then, okay, now that we have that figured out, how are we going to do this? Let's plan this out. Well, let's do a little diagram. And they do this, then all of a sudden, oh my goodness, I think it's 8 minutes. 8 minutes is almost up. Well, hurry, let's put this together. And it crashes and it doesn't work. What do we do? And they're done. And it crashed. It's down. This, you know, they just put a marshmallow on a piece of string, and they call it good. The kindergartners said, "Huh, let's try." Oh, that didn't work. And after 8 minutes, they've got a structure because it's an iterative approach. They try, fail, try, fail, try, fail, try, fail. And that's another fear that people have is that we're going to try this and we fail. And if we fail, we're not doing it anymore. And I've seen companies try it and fail and say, social stuff we're not doing anymore. No. You cannot take that approach. It has to be iterative. And so when you go back to strategy, when you go to your strategy, you may fail in a little strategy. Good, try something else. That didn't work. I always say, and a number of people are on the bandwagon of this, there are no best practices when it comes to E2.0, Enterprise 2.0 stuff. There are some good things that you can do, but every company is different, every culture is different, so you have to totally meld it to that. You're going to fail. Get used to it. Be comfortable with failure. And try something new. Try it again. With a community, if you're going to a specific community and saying, here, let me help you build this up so that you can learn from each other and so that you can collaborate even more, try something. It may not work. Okay, let's switch it. And set the expectation that this may not work from the get-go. That's okay. Dave Snowden. Anybody recognize the name? Just positive that's the name. Dave Snowden. He gives this little video, short video, about planning a birthday party. And do you plan it? Do you have your objectives? Do you sit down before to plan and set your objectives? And do you create inspirational posters? put them on the wall, have the kids come in, sit down, and go over with PowerPoint the objectives of the party and the rules, and then when they get out of line, say, get back in line, we're not to that point yet. No. But at the same time, do you just say, hey guys, come, and oh, by the way, here's all the alcohol you want and all the everything else that you want, and go crazy? You don't do that either. You have to find a good balance. You take what works and magnify it. You take what doesn't work and dampen and destroy it. It's that simple. I mean, that's, but you do the exact same thing. But people have to set the expectation that things will fail. So don't be afraid of that. We've got 5 minutes. Other questions? Yeah.
How do you know if it works? Do you measure it?
That's easy.
You started with
okay.
Purpose. If you met your purpose, then you were successful, right?
Your community will tell you.
Okay. All right answers. I mean, if you hit your purpose, good. But the problem with that is that your purpose changes constantly. It will always change because your purpose now is no longer this project, or you know what, we've changed because we found this isn't working in a business sense, so we have different goals, so we're going to go that way. If you take a relationship, a man and a woman get married, have you ever seen one where one is just blissfully happy? They think marriage is great. The other one's like, oh. Is the marriage successful? For one of them, it is, yeah. For the other one, it is. So when can you say that your community is successful? That's up to each individual person. And it is toward the goals at the same time. Yeah.
I facilitate a creative process, and about everything you said the last 7 minutes is everything
yes.
that you say about creative process.
Yes, absolutely. In fact, if you want to learn more about this, go study IDEO, the company IDEO, I-D-E-O. They create products, and the way they do it is they pull in a biologist for like, actually, go onto YouTube, look up IDEO shopping cart. Do a search for that. To create a new shopping cart, design for a shopping cart, they brought in a biologist, they brought in a psychologist, they brought in regular engineers, they brought in a mathematician, wide range to get different perspectives. And really that's what we're doing in social realm, is we want to bring in those different ways to look at different perspectives. Because when that happens, we get new perspectives. You have a question?
Well, you were talking about TED, and they had a presentation not long ago where they talked about what people tend to do in these social networks is birds of a feather flock together, mm-hmm. and you actually get less diversity than you would think, because now we can connect to everybody, but we choose to connect to people like
right.
us. And
right.
he talked about, if you look at the population on Facebook, and it's incredibly
yes.
international, but if you look at who's talking, who's connecting, everybody's with themselves.
You're right.
And so, you know, there's that little demotivator, none of us is as dumb as all of us,
yes.
and you get that kind of siloed effect where you hang out with people who talk like you,
sure,
think like you, and act like you.
Yeah. So you have to proactively bring those people in sometimes. That's a really good talk, by the way. So the last thing that I want to part with here is there are some great examples of this. Great. By the way, technology isn't what you should start with. It's the trust factor you should start with. People think it's the opposite. Blah, 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 blah. Here. Yeah. Okay. This is my warning for all of you. This is the last thing that I want to leave you with. Very stern warning, and I'll be very, very blunt about this. And I haven't written on my blog for a while, because this is the next post that I want to do, and I'm still churning this in my mind to put this all just right, because this has to do with more than just social things. Blockbuster is becoming a dinosaur because they didn't realize their purpose. Their purpose should have been not to rent movies, but it should have been to bring entertainment to homes. They got stuck so much in this in the way they do it that they became inflexible. Is that right? Inflexible? Inflexible. They couldn't move it because they said, this is the way we do things. This is how, and they took their eye off the goal. So when something else, so when a new need came out, they weren't ready to take advantage of it. But Netflix was. And so it was Redbox is another example. They came out and they're swamping Blockbuster. Microsoft Project is a great tool. But I've got it. I'm sure many of you have it. How many of us really use it? Unless you're a serious project manager, you probably just look at it and say, that's cool. And then start creating one and say, okay, that's really just too complicated. I'm not going to do it. Basecamp saw the need, though. And what Basecamp, 37signals.com, Basecamp said, you don't need that. For 90% of what project managers do, you don't need that. So they created something online, really easy to use. It's very, very social. In fact, very open. Blogs, discussions, wikis, adding those things in there. And tasks, project milestones. And they said, this is what you need. You don't need anything more than that. Their growth is incredible. Facilities management. At NASA, when computers came out, facilities management, that was the logical choice to put them. Then they just couldn't move out of where they were. So we created an IT department, as all companies have. Now here's the problem, is that we are going to next steps already. Is that we as learning and performance improvement professionals, we are so stuck in the way that we do things that we're missing this. And someone is going to come up behind us and take this, I'm gonna be selfish, and take this away from us. When we should be the ones who are guiding us. But you know who is? It's not IT, oddly enough. It's not marketing, it's not HR, it's not learning, it's not human performance. It's a new group. It's the Enterprise 2.0 group that they're coming, they're pulling from all these disciplines and they're creating their own. Because the other ones are not flexible enough to stand out, I have talked with I don't know how many learning groups for 3 years now doing presentations like this, and they still don't get it. They're scared that they're going to be replaced. And I guarantee you, if you're not looking at this stuff, if you don't be looking at it, if you're not looking at this, you may be replaced in some function or another. So this is my warning for you, is to look at this and see how it fits in your organization. And it'll fit differently for every single person, but don't let this go by. That's all I have, but if you want to gab afterwards, we can talk, okay? Thank you so much.